Federací zaměstnavatelských a podnikatelských svazů a Českou podnikatelskou reprezentací při Evropské unii. Možná mi dovolte na úvod vám říct jenom pár slov o tom, proč jsme se tuto debatu rozhodli uskutečnit. Tak asi není velkým tajemstvím, že jednou ze stěžejních priorit nové komise pod vedením paní Ursula von der Leyenové je tzv. Zelená dohoda pro Evropu. Ta byla, jak známo, představena, nebo její základní opisy představena v prosinci a jedním z jejich hlavních cílů je udělat z Evropy první klimaticky neutrální kontinent do roku 2050. Komise v prosinci nastínila plán, jakým způsobem snížit emise, ochránit klima, jakým způsobem ochránit volně žijící faunu, volně rostoucí floru, zlepšit stav životního prostředí a zároveň zvýšit životní úroveň našich evropských občanů. Z celkového objemu této ambice vyplývá, že to bude znamenat zásadní transformaci našeho hospodářského modelu, našeho, řekla bych, DNA naší ekonomiky. My se domníváme, Evropská komise se zmínila, že to v první řadě bude významná příležitost pro inovace a pro investice, včetně vědy a výzkumu, pro všechny evropské podniky. A samozřejmě doufáme, že se do toho zapojí i silný a inovativní zpracovatelský průmysl v České republice. Zároveň platí, že do tohoto procesu budou zapojena veškerá hospodářská odvětví, a to včetně sektoru uhlí, který bude při snižování emisí CO2 hrát velmi klíčovou roli. Proto se tato dnešní debata na tu uhelnou problematiku zaměřuje. Důvody jsou na snadě. Česká republika je spolu se sousedním Polskem jednou ze zemí, kde podíl uhlí na energetickém mixu je jeden z největších. Zároveň těžba uhlí představuje zásadní sektor, co se týče pracovních míst. Je na to navázáno zhruba v České republice 18 000 pracovních míst, což v celkovém počtu představuje asi 10% v celé Evropské unii. Komise si je toho vědomá, proto naším úkolem je zároveň zajistit, aby tento přechod, tato transformace byla sociálně co nejvíce citlivá a z hlediska hospodářství spravedlivá. To znamená, aby při té plnění té zelené dohody měly zůstanou opomenut, a to jak v českých, moravských, českých regionech. Proto pro usnadnění tohoto přechodu představila Evropská komise 14. ledna finanční plán, takzvaný investiční plán zelené dohody pro Evropu a mechanismus pro spravedlivou transformaci. Tady je ambicí nastartovat investice celé Evropské unii ve výši nejméně 1 bilionu eur. A to tak, aby část investic, která proporčně odpovídá velikosti ekonomiky České republiky a její expozici vůči uhlí, proběhla i v České republice. A o tom zejména fondu pro spravedlivou transformaci očekávám zejména dnešní debatu. Dámy a pánové, ještě jednou vás tady vítám a děkuju moc, že jste přišli na vzory podělnímu ránu v tomto počtu. Já doufám, že se nevidíme naposledy, že vás tady v Evropské unii budeme moct přivítat i při jiných příležitostech. Pořádáme zde spoustu seminářů, konferencí na různá témata. Můžete si sem přijít podívat i na nějaké evropské filmy v rámci evropského kina. Ale v každém případě pro tuto chvíli vám přeju inspirativní debatu. A již předávám slovo naší paní moderátorce, paní Julii Nestorskové, a poprosím mě, aby představila naše dnešní řečníky. Děkuju a pěkné dopoledne v Evropském domě.
Ředitel odboru energetické účinnosti a úspor ministerstva průmyslu a obchodu. Dobrý den, vítám vás. Vladimír Dlouhý, prezident hospodářské komory České republiky.
Dobrý den.
A jsem moc ráda, že mohu přivítat i tady pana Evgenia Tošinovského, poslance Evropského parlamentu. Kompletní. Jenom na začátek pár technických poznámek. Překlad z angličtiny bude na kanále číslo 1 do sluchátek. A za druhé vás poprosím, každý jste dostal takzvanou hlasovací krabičku. V průběhu debaty vám budou položeny některé otázky a poprosíme vás o odpovědi a nezapomeňte potom krabičku odepsat v chodu. A abych nezdržovala, poprosím o úvodní slovo pana Erika Unterbuchera. Děkuji.
Good morning and thank you for inviting me today. Yes, it's Monday morning, but I agree to see many people around, and I think it's also a reflection of the interest in this topic and the interesting topic. So I have a few slides prepared which explains to you maybe two things. The first one, yes, so it's good to see, yes, but it works, it does work. So. What I want to say on this slide, because we are talking about the Green Deal and the Sustainable European Investment Plan, which is actually one of the elements which implements the Green Deal, which was presented by the new Commission, by the President in December. So you see here, and I think this is something I would like to focus on, is how central the Green Deal is actually of our many policy areas, if not all policy areas. You have, of course, the area of investment, but you see also on the right side, agriculture. Of course, there's the need for sustainable agriculture and production. There is, of course, also the need for investments, and there's the need also in relation to trade, for example, but also to regulations when it comes to climate and energy targets. So I think it's important to underline this first. There is the main focus of the new Commission on the Green Deal, and I think this is something which we will discuss in detail also today, how to implement that. And when it comes to the implementation, let me say a few things before I go a little bit into detail of the just transition mechanism. In this publication of just a month ago, it was indicated that there will be 1,000 billion of euros available for investments in measures to reduce CO2 emissions and for fostering us to go along this pathway towards climate neutrality in 2050. So this sum, of course, is something which nobody really can understand, but it's composed of part of the budget, so the budget of the European Union, and everyone who is now looking to what's happening these days now, there is a discussion now at the European Council about the budget for the next 7 years. So a significant share of the budget is in relation to the Green Deal, but there are also other elements, for example, when it comes to the European Investment Bank. The European Investment Bank is the key European funding institution, also has changed the mandate now to invest up to 50% over the next year in investments in relation to Green Deal, in relation to CO2 reductions, and so on. So this is the overall financial package which outlines the scope of investments in relation to European investment for the next 10 years. And there's one element which is called, and I would like to focus on this, which is the just transition mechanism. And this mechanism basically has three pillars, pillar 1, 2, and 3. And I think when we are discussing today, particularly I think we will speak about pillar 1, and the pillar 1 is the Just Transition Fund. And it's always good to explain these figures, because I think 100 billion are more understandable when it comes to what we are financing. So we are saying here 40 to 50 billion from the Just Transition Fund. This relates to the investments from the fund, which is foreseen 7.5 billion. There are co-financing requirements on structural funds, and there's also requirements from national and regional co-financing, which brings us to this figure of 30 to 50 million. The next pillar is a private sector pillar. We will be very much, you might know, have seen our proposal to help to invest, we call it Invest EU. And part of the Invest in EU, which is a large package, of course, and I mentioned it also before, the European Investment Bank is part of, is in relation to private sector investment in relation to the Green Deal. And the third pillar is a public sector investment instrument, which is still being developed, which provides guarantees for loans to the public sector, and these loans will be essentially provided by the European Investment Bank, which brings us together to 100 billion. But I would also like to understand what is written on the bottom, because I think this money has a certain conditionality, and I think it's important to say we want to develop, when we come to the programming of the different instruments, particularly the Just Transition Fund, we want to see how there is a path there, as I said before, a strategy, a territorial strategy for CO2 neutrality by 2015. And of course there should be milestones in this territorial trajectory, we call it territorial transition plans. And these plans will be particularly important for the first pillar, the pillar of the Just Transition Fund, but it will also open up investments for the two other pillars, which I think is something which we would also like to keep in mind. So writing, and I think it's a national obligation, national regional obligation to write this plan over the next few months, is important also for opening up the investment to the pillar two and pillar three. Now, here we have a little bit more the way we are trying to, and I said my main focus will be on the Just Transition Fund. Therefore, I think keep in mind that I'm talking now about the programming of this fund, and we'll come back to the issue about how much Czech Republic is foreseen receiving from this fund. Let me also say this fund, which is part of the cohesion policy package, which is negotiated now, of course depends on an agreement between the Parliament and the legislator, Parliament and the Council. Now, we also would like to underline the point here when it comes to the investments. It's embedded in the European semester. This is this annual exercise of reviewing the economic performance of all member states. And this time the focus is on sustainability. Therefore, there will be a dedicated Annex D, Annex DB, we call it in our jargon, which will be presented very shortly, which outlines the area of investments in relation to the Just Transition Fund for all member states. I think it's also important to see when you are writing these strategies, the plans, it's important to take note about your commitments in relation to environmental and climate objectives. This is enshrined, of course, in the national plans. And I think it's important to underline also that there will be a review clause on the right upper corner. You see the, how far we are actually approaching towards the objectives of 2050 is in the next years to come. 2024, I think, is a key date for cohesion policy in any case, because there's the so-called mid-term review of cohesion policy programs. Once more, the Just Transition Fund is part of the cohesion policy funds. Therefore, just to enumerate them for the people who are not so familiar, it's the Regional Development Fund, it's the Social Fund, it is the Cohesion Fund, and Just Transition Fund. Now, important also to see that we actually deal with two layers, because of course, territorial plan means it's the territory, it's the region, it's possibly part of a region, which is affected by coal mining and related industries, and I think it's not only about coal mining and power stations, it's also about energy intensive and CO2 emitting industries, in fact, because there are some member states where the coal mining is not really an issue. Maybe I should also say this, the Just Transition Fund is for all 27 member states available, including Luxembourg, Malta, and Poland. And I think I make a reference to Poland, which is the largest coal producer in the European Union. So it is the territory, the regional territory, but also the national territory. And I think this is important to keep in mind, because we do want to have a commitment to phase out CO2 intensive coal mining and related power stations over the years to come, because the objective is 2050. So it's not just a plan which indicates the regional committee because a commitment, because quite often the regions do not have the power to do so. Keep this piece in mind. Now, when it comes, as I said, I will focus for my remaining 5 minutes on the scope of support. Here, very important to underline, we are talking about the transition in various sectors. We are talking not just the energy sector transition. I think it's important to keep this in mind when it comes to the implementation of the fund. We are talking about an economic transition, we are talking about a fair transition, that's why it's a just and fair fund, and we are talking also about a socially accepted transition. This is a really big issue, because I mean, we also not naive, you know, not understand, we do understand, for example, the Polish situation quite well, where there are 100,000, so 200,000 people actually directly and indirectly, of course, affected by mining in the Czech Republic itself, so a similar scale, 20,000 people and related indirectly. So we do not understand, of course, there's an obligation to make this transition socially acceptable. And I think this is something important. It's also it's a pathway. It's not that we are phasing out coal production tomorrow over the years. It will go over the time, and we have this objective 2050. So Europe is on the lead in this objective, at least. Understand this also, and we have all our contribution to make there. Now, here you see, for example, to underline, we want economic diversification and reconversion. Of course, this is what I already indicated. It relates very much to economic development, and we want to create jobs, opportunities for the people working there and their families, which are adequately paid. I always would like to underline this point. We're talking about the fair and just transition, which is an important aspect in which we should never forget. There are certain technical details. I don't want to go into this detail now. Here, some sort of exclusion. We will not finance fossil fuel under this fund. And by the way, under cohesion policy, we are also not financing fossil fuels in any other fund. I think it's important also to underline this point. But I think when it comes to Pillar 2 and 3, there is some sort of flexibility. We also understand that in some member states do actually have, so of course, a challenge ahead if they want to go from coal to non-CO2 fossil fuels, that there must be some transitional steps taken, which also can be financed from Pillar 2 and 3. And then we are opening up some sort of possibilities for large enterprises and enterprises which are taking part under the emission trading scheme. These are exclusions under cohesion policy, under conventional cohesion policy, let's put it like this. Please keep this in mind. And therefore, here we are having a slight opening up to large enterprises. If this is necessary, I underline this point, if this is necessary to create jobs in relation to the transition. So this is not a blanco opening up for large enterprises or EPS schemes. This is very, very much tailored and needs to be well justified, and we look into this very carefully. Maybe I should also say that, of course, this will be discussed later on, how do we see to implement this fund or these investments? There are different ways. I don't know whether you have really seen already the regulation, the draft regulation, which is also part of the negotiations. We can possibly foresee a separate program, which possibly is not necessary in the context of the Czech Republic, but maybe part of the program and so on. There are different ways, but I think it's important here to underline it has to be embedded into the logic of cohesion policy of economic development, and we have this additional element now to provide additional funds for key investments in relation to the transition, which comes now to the second last slide, which is the allocation for the Czech Republic. Let me say it's important allocation. It's the number four. Largest allocation is for Poland. I said it before, 7.5 billion euros for the Just Transition Fund. Let me also say these figures I've mentioned before. I started with 1,000, then I'm going to 100 billion, then I'm going to 40 billion, and now I'm ending up with 7.5 billion. 7.5 billion is fresh money. Please keep this in mind. And it's not going to be something which is an on-off. We foresee this is going to be the key element of cohesion policies in the years to come. The objective, as I said before, is 2050. This is not tomorrow, but this is the day after tomorrow, so it's very, very soon. And we are talking here about 10 years, actually. Essentially, we are talking about 10 years, because cohesion policy in the multi-annual financial framework is only 7 years, and there's an add-on period of 2 years. These last 2 or 3 years are overlapping with the next period. So this is really the opening up for the next period, post-27, so to speak. This is long, long ahead, but of course I think it's important to keep in mind. And now I'm coming to this money, is important also to see. We are talking here about, for the Czech Republic, 581 million. Number four after Poland, Germany and Romania. Romania is also an important coal producer in particular. I think it's you keep this in mind also. And number four is the Czech Republic. And it comes now to the different funding opportunities, which I've said before, co-financing requirements. This is within cohesion policy, but also national co-financing. We have a scope of 2 to 3 billion, and then it comes to the excess of either 2 and 3, we are talking about almost 8 billion. And this is actually around 8% of the total allocation from this 100 billion. So I think it is substantial, and I think there's no time to waste. I tell you also, we are going out to start very soon, maybe later today in the morning, in the afternoon, how these funds should be programmed. But it's not just about programming, it's not just about writing documents, actually it's also to create investment opportunities. So you will have to very soon come forward with concrete projects to invest. Once more, I don't think so that this is something we should think about, that we are replacing coal mines by renewable energy installations. Maybe that might be something. But it's about creating jobs. It is really important. So research, innovation, new enterprises, maybe also some limited provision of infrastructure, if it fits into this. For example, infrastructure which we will also not finance under the Just Transition Fund could be provided by mainstream cohesion policy programs and so on. So this can be mixed and blended together. But I think keep really in mind we're talking about an economic transition. And when it comes, and this is the final point because I'm exceeding my time. This is the, only one point. We're talking about the coal regions in transition, and this is not the Just Transition Fund. It's not even a precursor, but it's something that we actually can build on, and we are building on very fundamentally on this, because it's already the regions, and you know these regions much better than I do, where are the coal mining regions and where are the regions where there is an air pollution problem, and there's also the industry possibly affected. So these are the regions where we very much work on together with the national authorities in the framework of Restart. So this is really the building block, but it's not the same, because now we are implementing still under this funding period, which is still open until 2023, in concrete steps for certain regions, projects, and the project eligibility is not the same. I think it is also important to keep this in mind, but it's a very, very good actually starting point, a leaping spot, so to speak, for the rollout of the Just Transition Fund. And I think it's important to keep this in mind. Here we are already indicating that the focus should be on SMEs, economic development, as I said before, and other areas. And I think, let's not forget, I'm here the representative from the European Commission, and I'm with DG Regional Policy, but I have a sister DG, and I think I would like to close with this one, which is, of course, employment. And here's the first point. I think we have an obligation also to provide the capacity and the possibilities for people working there to get higher skills, which then can be used in new services and new industries and for research and innovation. Of course, not for all, I know that, but why not actually trying it also very fundamentally from that point of view. So this was a very short presentation of the Just Transition Fund. I just hope that we are going to make progress now over the next few days, not me, but our legislators. I know everyone in the Brussels community talks these days about this, even over the weekend and so. Let's be positive and let's hope that we get an agreement. So thank you very much for, and we'll send a little bit of questions later on anyway. So thank you very much.
Předatelé pro regionální rozvoj za to, co se na tom a poprosím rovnou pana poslance Košenovského krátkou vstupní řeč. Děkuji.
Dobrý den, já se v prvé řadě omlouvám za pozdní příchod, ale po účasti v Praze rozhodují České reálie a Pendolino je neslovový bojovník, takže jsme doběhli akorát, jak to vyšlo. Takže se omlouvám za ten pozdní příklad a ještě když jsem zase budu možná trochu dřív prchat, protože zase Brusel volá, protože začínají ta jednání, o který pan ředitel hovořil. Já možná začnu trošku ze širka, pak to velmi zhustím. Já si troufám říct, zkusím se nazvat válečným primátorem Ostravy, protože jsem zažil v dobu v Ostravě, a to bylo první setkání tady s Vladimírem Dlouhým, s panem prezidentem hospodářské komory, kdy probíhala restrukturalizace Ostravy jako takové. Byl to přijel jenom na Ostravu. V té době, já jsem nastoupil někdy v roce 1993 v listopadu a v roce 1994 byl zavřen poslední důl v Ostravě. Zažil jsem zavírání asi 7 koksoven, po kterých jsem všech chodil a vysvětloval, že je potřeba je zavřít. Zažil jsem nezbytné ukončení aglomerací, což kdo neví, co jsou aglomerace, tak to je vlastně, kdy se dovezla železná ruda a ta se spíká a tak, aby to byla vsáska. Zavírali jsme i vysoké pece uprostřed Ostravy. Od té doby došlo k ohromnému vylepšení životního prostředí, tak jak v Praze se bojovalo o demokracii, tak část bojů v Ostravě v roce 1989 bylo o čistotu ovzduší, protože byl to dramatický, zásadní problém. Za tu dobu se snížily některé velmi nepříjemné splodiny až o 90%, jako právě ten popílek, což byl generátor právě ty aglomerace. Takže vím, co to znamená a dovedu si představit, že jestliže charakterizujeme a říkáme, to je v těchto dokumentech, že došlo ke snížení CO2 a veškerých poutantů došlo o 23%, takže v roce 30 bude jednoduché dosáhnout 55, tak to tak optimisticky nevidím. Protože tenkrát jsme šli z úrovně hrůzy, a to říkám jako člověk, který zažil Ostravu, kdy sníh, když napadl, tak byl 2 hodiny teprve jenom bílý a pak už byl černý. Do města, které je standardní, akorát zůstaly některé lokální věci. Proto si myslím, že ta představa, že to půjde stejně dramaticky a jednoduše, je velmi, velmi optimistická, když budu chtít říct. Ať začnu s něčím pozitivním, já si myslím, že je úplně v pořádku, že Green Deal upozorňuje na životní prostředí, že má snahu společnost obecně evropská dospěla do nějakého stádia a do i určité úrovně poznání ekonomického a má se věnovat víc životnímu prostředí, než to bylo, když já jsem přišel na to primátorské křeslo. To si myslím, že je v pořádku. Na druhé straně mám obavu, že soustředění na CO2 a stala se z toho ideologie a mizí z toho ekonomika velmi silně. Mám obavu, že je velmi nebezpečný krok. Jestli tady se a v tom materiálu je uvedeno, Just Transition Fundu je uvedeno, že se to bude týkat 108 regionů a zhruba 240 tisíc zaměstnaných ve fosilních palivech, pak jsou další desítky tisíc břidličných a dalších zdrojích. Tak to číslo je velmi optimistické. Stejně tak, a nebudu používat Ostravu, která už jednou prošla něčím a ten druhý krok bude velmi těžký a dramatický. Za 10 let vytěsnit uhlí z života bude teda kousek. A mám obavu, aby to neohrozilo celistvost Evropské unie, ne že by došlo k Czechzitu, ale obecně k negativnímu přístupu lidí, protože budou přicházet o zaměstnání. A proto jsem začal tím válečným primátorem. Vím, co je říkat lidem, já jsem říkal v 10 hodin večer na vysoké peci, kdy ti poši v těch stříbrných kabátech slezli z vysoké pece a říkali jim, tady to zavřeme a musí se to zavřít. To bude muset někdo udělat a mám obavu, že to nebude říkat komise. To budou říkat místní politici, bude to zasahovat do místní politiky. Stane se to velmi složitým politickým argumentem. Zažil jsem to a vím, že to není vůbec nic jednoduchého.